always trust.
I asked. We ask the questions.
What is needed in the world?
Is that going to be?
Phil Reese je šef Al Jazeerinog odjela za istraživačko novinarstvo. Imao je ključnu ulogu u uspostavi istraživačke jedinice Al Jazeere. Diplomirao je na Oxfordu, a 82. počeo raditi za BBC. Tokom 23 godine provedene u toj kompaniji pokrivao je Aziju, Bliski istok, Afriku te Južnu i Sjevernu Ameriku. Autor je brojnih članaka, bio je prezenter i producent u najmanje 60 dokumentarnih filmova, osvojio više od 20 međunarodnih nagrada. Autor je dokumentarnih filmova koji se bave tematikom Balkana, Posljednje uporište Srba i Sloba i mira. Njegovu knjigu Večera s teroristima, objavljenu 2006. godine, Noam Chomsky je nazvao izvanrednom, a Guardian bravurom. U Sarajevo stigao povodom AJB Doka.
Mr. Reese, thank you very much for being with us.
My pleasure.
We have the opportunity to see all different films by the Al Jazeera investigative unit here on the Al Jazeera Balkans news channel. Many of them have shown serious hard work, and also many of them were rather shocking, as I may say, as something like, you know, changing, even influencing governments, democracies, like in the United Kingdom. So after one of the film, The Lobby, in the United Kingdom, there was a sort of feeling like what is going on when we don't, what we don't know. So the question is, to what extent has this movie or other movies changed the perception of the world, the way we see the world today?
Well, I think lobby groups, they're by definition, their intent is to try to manipulate democracy. They try to influence voters in a way that is separate from the truth. So I think that, you know, the investigative unit, one of its main targets should be to show what lobby groups are doing. Now, this may be lobby groups for wanting to sell things, wanting to influence government in different ways, but of course governments themselves have got very, very powerful lobby groups. And I think what we exposed there is something I've wanted to expose for some time, is the pro-Israel lobby. They're very, very effective in promoting Israel in the Western world and in the Western media, and in preventing an open discussion about equal rights for Palestinians. And I think what we saw in the four-part lobby series focused on the United Kingdom, and by the way, it resulted in one of the diplomats being sent back, and an apology from the ambassador, the Mark Regev, the Israeli ambassador to the United Kingdom. So what we saw there was a diplomat going well outside conventional diplomatic practice and effectively trying to manipulate groups within the British Labour Party. And they were doing that because they're very worried that Britain now has a Labour Party that might change its policies towards Israel and actually have a much greater recognition for the rights of Palestinians. And that frightens Israel at the moment. So we had quite a reaction from that. But, you know, we've looked at other lobby groups. I mean, our last film looked at the National Rifle Association of America. And, you know, particularly if you look at the United States, lobby groups have a way of distorting democracy. Investigative journalism, one of its primary roles, in my view, is to work in the public interest to give the public the facts they need to make a proper democratic decision.
After airing the films, I've heard people saying, I don't believe in democracy anymore. What do you feel about this issue?
Well, I don't think one should in any way reject democracy. Remember, if you look back at the emergence of investigative journalism and the emergence of public relations, they almost started at the same time in the United States after what's called the muckrakers. Upton Sinclair looked at sanitary conditions in meat factories. Standard Oil, the big oil conglomerate, was challenged by journalists. As a result of that, the powerful started putting money into public relations. And that's because there's a democracy out there. People do choose in Western countries and in you know, other parts of the world. So the battleground is how do you persuade them what's right and wrong, and how do you make them vote for certain things? So, you know, this is in a way standard policy, but I think there's not enough journalistic concern to really address what lobby groups are doing, because in my view, they're largely pernicious, and by definition, their role is to prevent people having an objective truth.
And Why do you think journalists are not that interested in, you know, going deep investigative stories? Like after this UK lobby film, I've heard some comments from the United Kingdom saying, why some British television hasn't done it? Why the BBC perhaps hasn't revealed such a breach of democracy, or other news channel in the United Kingdom?
Well, I mean, I'm prepared to say that I was, in 1997, I raised an idea that was looking at something quite similar, which was Israeli influence in Congress in the United States. And that program was stopped. Now, I'm not trying to, you know, say there are big conspiracies here, but the very power of, for example, the pro-Israel lobby doesn't just exert itself on politicians, it exerts itself on politicians on broadcasters as well. And I know full well from fellow journalists who've reported there how members of the Israel lobby will phone up senior BBC executives. They know exactly who to call. They can go to above them, to the Director General. They then go to Downing Street. They have, and you know, this is not a conspiracy we're talking about here. We're just talking about very effective lobbying. And you know, you can argue that, you know, that's fair enough for Israel to do that. But you know, certainly I think the job of journalists is to counter that. And of course, one of the things which we've also found in Britain now is that the Israel lobby, unlike, for example, the Turkish lobby or, you know, Bosnian lobby, I mean, every country lobbies for itself. But what the Israel lobby tries to do is it lobbies for Israel, is the first punch, but it has a second punch, which basically says if you criticize Israel, if you talk about the lobby, then you're going to be accused of being anti-Semitic. And, you know, we were at Al Jazeera after the series we did on the lobby, and it was ridiculous. I mean, it's nothing to do whatsoever with that. And, you know, quite frankly, anti-Semitism is such a terrible, pernicious thing. I mean, it's something that has scarred Europe, all right, that for people to associate that with criticism of Israel actually belittles the real threat that anti-Semitism does exist from far-right groups in parts of the world, you know. But often there are people within the state of Israel who will accuse those who campaign for Palestinian rights as being anti-Semitic, which in my view is very, very dangerous actually for the very nature of how serious anti-Semitism is.
So how important it was to establish the Al Jazeera investigative unit?
Well, I think it was, you know, very, very important. I mean, I wasn't there at the beginning. My predecessor, you know, Clayton Swisher, was instrumental in setting it up. And I'd had discussions prior to 2013 when it was set up, but it you know, unfortunately, and you know, I was at the BBC for 23 years and worked at Channel 4, investigative journalism is expensive. And it does need somebody to really believe in it, somebody to believe in uncovering wrongdoing and have the money to do so. And I'm in a very privileged position, really, because I've seen the BBC cut back. And you know, if you're going to challenge power, you need to be powerful yourself, you know. Otherwise, they'll threaten you, they'll send, you know, expensive lawyers demanding vast amounts of money. There's a process of intimidation that takes place. And you've got to be strong. And I'm very pleased to say that Al Jazeera Media Network, you know, stands behind us proudly and allows us to do this work. But without that, I think that it's barely worth starting, barely worth doing it, if you're not up for the fight.
The investigative journalism needs lots of courage and risk, taking risk. And the Watergate scandal or process came across my mind. And do you see nowadays in the world where we see so many extraordinary things in our democracies, especially in the biggest one in the United States of America, do you see that there are journalists who are willing to risk so many things, you know, to bring forward the truth and to make a corrupt administration go away? We haven't seen any impeachment yet, resignation and so on. What do you feel about journalists nowadays as compared to the situation leading to a Watergate scandal situation? Or?
Well, I mean, the tapestry of media has changed dramatically, and we're in the midst of a massive communications revolution. And I think the effects of that are not yet known. After all, it's only been 10 years or so since Facebook exists. I think the problem that we've got is that there's the truth, and that there is a battle for verifiable truth now. It's as if there's no such consensus over it. I actually disagree with that. I think, and this is where I think long-form investigative work and long-form documentaries are necessary, because you've got to present the evidence, and that evidence cannot be questioned, and it has to be copper-bottomed, it has to be solid. Because what you've got now is a tradition of people saying, well, no, I have an alternative truth. No, that's not true, I have this. And within the world of Twitter, within the contracting news cycles, it kind of picks up a credibility, even though it was based on nothing. So I think that, you know, people have got to stand back, and you know, the whole world of Twitter, Facebook, creating this momentum of half-truths, you know, needs to be challenged. And I still think there is such a thing as verifiable truth, and everything we do is empirically founded, evidentially based. And I think it's important that that premise is there for journalism, because it is being challenged by people who are deliberately trying to misuse the truth for their own political gain.
So there is a room or future for serious investigative journalism, or journalism at all?
I think it's more needed now than ever.
Of course, but what do you think, what are the tools or possibilities to tackle on the fake news phenomena we are facing right now? You know, we have the immense universe of internet and so on, and so many possibilities. And it has proved to be very difficult to tackle the fake news phenomena.
Well, you know, it's very cheap to have, you know, a few hundred people just writing garbage and just churning this out through bots and creating what appears to be a consensus around certain things. It's very cheap to do that. So, I mean, I would say that to all the major news organizations that I think there is an urgent need to create sort of an index of verifiability. And I would say that investigation and looking at those subjects that are being debated as to what's true or not is an essential way of revealing it. It takes time, though. And, you know, for people like Trump, you know, time for him is, you know, it's one day makes, you know, is a long time, if you know what I mean, in terms of what he says, because he'll come out with something totally contradictory the next day. And, you know, he doesn't seem to care. But, you know, maybe I'm old-fashioned here, but I still believe that with the right evidence and the right amount of journalistic credibility, voters are interested in the truth. You know, they're not just interested in their own prejudices. But, you know, we're facing an uphill battle, though, because, you know, people now only look for news that reinforces their stereotypes and their prejudices. So, you know, far be it from the internet offering us a world where everybody's talking to each other and communicating, what is created are people who simply have their own group of friends who basically are echo chambers for their own views, often views you know, that are stereotypical. I mean, I do think there are two sorts of journalism, by the way. One is ones that reveal things, new truths, all right? And the other, and then shines a light into the dark areas. And the other is the kind of news that fear is based on fear. It scares people. It reinforces their prejudices. It makes them scared about the future. And I think that that latter form of news is what tabloid news in Britain, for example, and around the world has churned out. It's created, and you know, in America as well, to these you know, groups of Trump supporters. They've been fed that the outside world, Muslims, you know, Mexicans, you know, anybody is out to get them somehow, take their guns away. And I think that the politics of fear has been something that has Western society has been based on, European American, all right, since 2001. And I think that was deliberately formulated by certain vested interest groups that have now seen the fruition of it. And this goes back to neoliberalism and, you know, the way that the 1% have now become powerful. Because let me ask you this, Sasha, how is it that a majority of people vote, or in a democracy, for an economic system that makes them poorer and makes 1% of people wealthier? It's an amazing trick, isn't it? Nobody would rationally do that unless they are fed lies. Lies about the nature of their nationhood, nature of the threat to their lives, to, you know, the threat posed by the whole world around them of people of different color skin. And, you know, I think that has been embraced by so many people around the world now. And I think, you know who they are, whether it's Brazil, Hungary, you know, Britain now, United States.
Excellent question. So many of them, even presidents involved in rows and, like Brazilian president exchanging bad words with the French president or first lady, the president of the United States insulting almost half of the world. Those figures, alongside with United Kingdom and the European Union, are branded as leaders of the free world. And when you have a leader of the free world, the president of the United States, acting thus in this totally unusual way, let me say unusual, so then what is the future of the free world?
Well, I can't obviously answer that immediately, but this phenomenon is not always new. I mean, we know within Roman society they had the phrase bread and circuses, and you know Mussolini then used that again, which was basically to deny intelligent debate, to deny intelligentsia, to deny people who know anything about it. And you know that phrase to me is what's going on now as well. They're giving people a little bit of bread and they're keeping them entertained in some other way. If you look at the war in Iraq, for example, that the United States took over, and it happened in Britain as well. Anybody who knew anything about Iraq were denied the debate there, all right? It was done by a small number of people who didn't know anything, who believed they could impose their own reality on the world. Now, that is completely frightening, but I don't think it'll win in the end because, you know, look, Al Jazeera takes a very different philosophy of the media, and we need more channels like Al Jazeera globally, all right, that wants people to address the issues, wants people to be informed, wants them to be intelligent. That actually is probably the battleground that we're facing politically now. It's not what people in the end decide, but can they be informed to make the right decisions about themselves and about where they live?
So there is room, there is a future for serious media outlets as compared to, you know, streaming or other forms of television or receiving program, to say that way.
I think there is, though, you know, there are question marks over the platforms and, you know, that, you know, is in a state of change now. But, you know, young people, you know, you saw, we've been looking at, you know, protests about the environment. I mean, young people are very agitated. I mean,
teenagers.
Teenagers are very aware of things about the environment, the growth of vegetarianism about there because they don't want to destroy the environment, interest in animal rights. You know, young people are very informed. Do they sit and watch linear television with their parents, you know, every evening like they used to maybe, you know, when I was coming up? Well, no, I don't think that's the case. But that doesn't mean that they're not communicating and being informed about these very, very important issues. And I actually think that this generation now will be responding to the last 20 or 30 years where dumbing down was taking place, where dumbing down was deliberately taking place by some very, very powerful people who didn't want an informed electorate, certainly in Western countries, you know, Europe and the United States. So I think that, you know, I'm optimistic, actually. I'm optimistic that some of these things will change. And we started talking about the Israel lobby. One of the things you're finding throughout the world now, why Israel is so frightened, is that lots of young Jews now in America and in Britain, they don't want to associate themselves with Israel. I mean, Judaism has a huge history of fighting injustice, of, you know, it has a wonderful history of that. And they do not want to associate with the people who are now running Israel. So, you know, what you've got, I think, is a demographic change based on age for the first time. I mean, there's been some, you know, if you look at former elections, some change, but like in Britain, 70% of young people voted for Jeremy Corbyn in the last election. I mean, that's unheard of in terms of a division of young and old. And if people over 60 were excluded from some of the elections like Trump, like Britain leaving the European Union or the Scottish referendum, they would have gone the other way.
You've mentioned the United Kingdom and Brexit is a word usually jumping around, if I may say so. What do you feel like when you hear the word Brexit?
Well, you know, I'm Welsh, and you know, the United Kingdom is an entity of four nations. Brexit to me is a horror story because I think the motivation for it was xenophobic, in some cases racist. You know, one can argue whether the European Union is well run, whether it's wasteful, whether it should be reformed in some way. But when I hear the word Brexit, I get a deep sense of sadness about, you know, my compatriots. And by the way, it was wafer thin, like all of these elections now, you know, one, you know, on a hair's breadth, really, on a couple of percent anyways. And it makes me
52-48,
something like that. You know, well, look at Trump's win. Look at, you know, many of the key elections, even George, you know, Bush the second against Al Gore. There's a handful of people in Florida. So some of the decisions that have really affected our world recently have been won by a very, very narrow margin. And I think that, unfortunately, the people of Britain were fed fear. They were fed fear about number of immigrants coming in. They've had fear about Muslims. You know, fear about Eastern Europeans, all of this kind of stuff, that your culture is under threat, Britain can be great on its own. It's a fiction, it's a lie, and, you know, sadly, and I do hope, by the way, that there will be another election and that will change. So I'm not altogether as negative as I was.
Do you feel like this could be the end of the European Union as we know it?
I don't think so.
Well,
I mean, I don't
just
think
the idea of European Union, the idea which was behind this process that led to this kind of union nowadays.
Well, I mean, I think obviously the European Union was a Franco-German issue in the beginning, obviously in the 1950s when the ideas emerged. So I think, you know, they are at the core of it. I mean, it'll be a blow if Britain does leave, but I don't think it's the end, and I certainly hope not. Because, you know, this part of the world has had its own wars in recent history. And, you know, the idea of the European Union was to prevent another Franco-German war. There have been several in, you know, three in the century before, before the 1950s. So, you know, the whole point of it was to prevent wars, that being the fundamental thing. And I think that, you know, it's not going to happen in Europe, in Western Europe again. I really hope it doesn't happen here, but the best way to try to do this is create a community of people with free borders, with open borders, who can have dialogue and know each other from different communities.
And communicate. You've been to the Balkans before many times, before you made your films The Serb Last Stand and Sloba and Mira, among others. And the Balkans is an interesting part of Europe, so beautiful by nature, but so polluted by politics. It seems to me it's been an inspiration for rather many filmmakers, but unfortunately it continues to be.
Well, look, certainly that it's at one of those parts of the world, I mean, you know, where the Rohingya live now between Myanmar and Bangladesh is one or two, where kind of almost like the political seismic plates, you know, are moving, and you know, it's where the earthquake can happen. So, you know, it's unfortunate about that, but you know, I think the people here are absolutely wonderful. I really, really hope that there won't be any more conflict. I do think that, you know, the Dayton Accords, which brought the peace prior to Kosovo, were based on ethnic cleansing, though. And I think it set an unfortunate precedent. The independence of Kosovo set another fundamental precedent in the region. I know for Bosnia, perhaps that's the biggest, you know, problem in terms of it being a kind of binational country at the moment, but you know, I don't think that, you know, it will, you know, will Serbia try to annex, for example, northern Bosnia, Republika Srpska? Well, you know what? I think one of the biggest breaks on that is the enticement of the Serbian government to join the European Union. So in that sense, you know, no, I don't think so. Not in the near future. I think there needs to be a better political solution to it. Because I don't think the situation in Bosnia now is something that's going to last 100 years, if you know what I mean. But nevertheless, I think that the more the people of the whole region are able to talk and learn from each other. But remember as well, it wasn't the people, it wasn't who suffered. You know, the Bosnians here suffered in terms of the deaths and the horrible. You know, I was here when, you know, the snipers were firing over Sarajevo. But if you look at the people whose identity and sort of cultural a role suffered most, it was the Serbs of the Krajina, who fled in their thousands during Operation Storm, which I also covered in Knin and all that. And you know, and the Serbs of Kosovo as well. I mean, you know, there wasn't, I knew many of them. When I went back afterwards, I knocked on the doors of where they lived and they'd all gone again. Now, you know, the question of the identity of what it means to be a Serb needed to be changed and is evolving, okay? But remember, it's the politicians who started those wars deliberately for their own power. And it's not just Milosevic, I would blame Tudjman as much as anyone else. And I think that therefore what this region must be aware of is those politicians must be part of a wider European culture and understand that that is not the way to get political success.
Do you feel they understand it even now? Do you feel that the situation has changed?
Is changing? I think it is changing. Perhaps not as much as one would like it to change, or I would like it to change. But look, I haven't been to Belgrade for a while, but I mean, it's a different place from, you know, back in the, you know, in the mid 90s. And of course, you know, even in Serbia, there's been a large number of people who opposed Milosevic, and, you know, large people who were disgusted by what, you know, Mladic and you know, was doing up in these hills here. So I don't think that you can, you know, brand a whole country there. But what you can look at, and that is absolutely important that this isn't starting again, that politicians who feel weak, who want to maintain their own power, are going to play politics with their own people and play the nationalist card. And that's where wars start.
And we meet here in Sarajevo for the AJB ad hoc, where you lead the training, storytelling, using investigative journalism. Do you feel, now do you see young generations taking somewhat a different approach? They are more pro-European, pro-Western. Are they interested in the training? What do you feel about them?
Well, certainly the people here, and I mean, I've been very pleased to see Serbs here. I've seen, you know, people from Belgrade, people from Zagreb. So I think that here, that's absolutely the case. I mean, you know, whether, I'm not in a position to say whether that represents the young people of these areas, and, you know, whether there are malign forces that are trying to maybe play with their fears. But, you know, coming here, it's great to see, and, you know, what a wonderful role AJB Al Jazeera Balkans does in bringing together the whole of the Balkans to have a platform for dialogue. And, you know, that's what Al Jazeera has done in the Middle East. It's a great thing. It's not a matter of who you agree with or who's right. It's a matter that if people are able to talk, that's a first step to stop than picking up a gun and fighting.
Mr. Rees, thank you very much for having this opportunity to talk to you.
My pleasure.